Hi everyone! In this video we're going to learn about a very useful function that's called the unit step function. And here its definition. The unit step function is a piecewise defined function. It takes value 0 for values of t from 0 to a, and it takes value 1 for t equals a or anything that's greater. The unit step function is usually denoted by this fancy u, and the value of t at which this change happens from 0 to 1 is written over here. So here's an example. We read this as the unit step function at 2 is defined in the following way. The value of the function is 0 from t values from 0 to 2, and then at 2 it switches to 1, and after that it remains as 1. The easiest way to understand the unit step function is by looking at its graph. Here it is. We can see how the function value is 0 from 0 to 2, and then it becomes 1 for all values of t that are greater than or equal to 2. Because of the nature of this function, it's very common to look at it as an on and off switch. So when the value of the function is 0, we say that it's off, and when the value of the function becomes 1, it's on. And in a moment, we're going to see that when the unit step function is combined, well, I should say multiplied, with another function, we can say that it turns on or off that other function. But before I show you that, I just want to make a note that the unit step function is also called Heaviside step function, and it's named after an English mathematician, Oliver Heaviside. So, what happens if we multiply another function by the unit step function? Let's consider the following simple example. Here we have the unit step function at 4 being multiplied by linear function 3t. Since the unit step function is a piecewise defined function, this product will also be a piecewise defined function. Let's use the definition of the unit step function to figure out how this function will look like. Well, we know that by the definition, this unit step function equals 0 for all values of t between 0 and 4. Well, and we know that 0 times anything is 0. That means that this product equals 0 for all values of t from 0 to 4. We also know that based on the definition, this unit step function will be equal to 1 for all values of t greater than or equal to 4. Well, 1 times 3t is 3t. So that's what this piecewise defined function is going to have here. Let's look at the graph of this piecewise defined function. First of all, what is the graph of 3t? Well, it's a linear function. So it's graphed just a straight line. And this is how the graph of this piecewise defined function is going to look like. From 0 to 4, it equals 0. And after 4, we now see the portion of the graph of the function 3t. And again, if we think about the unit step function as on and off function, then when it's combined or multiplied with the function 3t, we can say that it turns it on at t equals 4. Here's one more example for you. Look at what we have now. We have function in the form 3t minus 3t times the unit step function at 4. Well, since the unit step function is involved in this expression, it means that this function f is also a piecewise defined function. Let's try to figure out how it's going to look like. So let's focus on the interval from 0 to 4. We know that on that interval, the unit step function equals 0, and the product of that and 3t is 0 as well. So this part is 0 on the interval from 0 to 4, but then 3t minus 0 is just 3t. So that is the first piece. Now let's analyze the second piece, the second interval. So the second interval is all values of t that are greater than or equal to 4. On that interval, the unit step function equals 1. Now the product of 3t and 1 is 3t, but then what happens when we subtract? 3t minus 3t is 0. So this piecewise defined function equals 0 for all values of t that are greater than or equal to 4. And this is how the graph of this function is going to look like. So from 0 to 4, we can see graph of the function 3t. And then after 4, it's just 0. And if we think about this in terms of the function being turned on or off, in this case, function 3t is being turned off at t equals 4. And now as we compare these two examples side by side, we can see that the unit step function can be used to either turn on the other function or to turn it off. And that makes the unit step function very useful in a lot of different applications. For instance, the second example we just looked at can be used to model voltage in a circuit where it's getting turned off at certain value of t. And in general, applications of the unit step function can be found in physical sciences, engineering, and computer science. Let's summarize and generalize what we've learned so far about the unit step function and look at a few more interesting cases. For that, we're going to use this arbitrary function f of t. We're looking at its graph. First, let's refresh what happens when we multiply this function f of t by the unit step function at a. Well, that's when the function f of t gets turned on at value a. Up to that point, the value of this product is 0, and then at a, function f of t gets turned on, and we can see, you know, this portion of the function. Now, how about this function where we have f of t minus f of t times the unit step function at a? Well, it's just basically the opposite of what we just looked at. In other words, the function f of t being turned off at a. So here's the portion of the function f of t, this portion here. And then it gets turned off, and we just see value 0 after that. Now, example 3 is very similar to example 2. Do you notice the difference? Well, in this case, the unit step function is at b. So overall, the idea is the same as example 2. Function f of t is being turned off, but this time at value b. Here is the graph. Function f being turned off at b. Now, example 4 is interesting. So here we have function f of t being multiplied by the unit step function at a minus f of t times the unit step function at b. To better understand what's going on here, let's do a little bit of algebra. So first I notice that there's f of t in both terms, so I can simply factor f of t out. And the way we look at it is that now f of t is being multiplied by this piecewise defined function that consists of a difference of two unit step functions. And let's think what this all means. For that, I'm going to bring back the definition of the unit step function. And let's use this table to help us to organize our thinking. So first, let's look at the unit step function at a. We know that by the definition, the value of this function is 0 until a, and after a, it's going to be 1. So in my table, I have to write 0 over here for values of t from 0 to a, and then after that, t between a and b, it's going to be 1, and after that, it's still going to be 1. So the value of this function after a is 1. How about this unit step function at b? Well, it's going to be equal 0 from 0 to b, so I'll have to put 0 here from 0 to a, and from a to b, it's still 0, and at b and after, the value of this function is 1. And to complete the last column, we'd simply have to find the difference between the these values. So 0 minus 0 is 0, 1 minus 0 is 1, and 1 minus 1 is 0. So what does this mean? That means that our function f of t is being multiplied by 0 on the interval from 0 to a, so the product becomes 0. Then function f of t is being multiplied by 1 on the interval from a to b, so the result is f of t. And then after that, function f of t is being multiplied by 0 again, so the result is 0. So in other words, in this case, we can only see the function f of t, or we should say it's being turned on only on the interval from a to b. So this is how the graph is going to look like. So this portion that we can see, that's the portion where the function f of t is being turned on, is this portion over here from a to b. Of course, you don't have to do all those steps every time. You just need to remember that if you have this kind of structure of the function, then function f of t is being turned on between values a and b. Well, let's look at a few more examples. So this is how the function example 5 is defined. So let's see what we have here. So first of all, I can see the unit step function at b. I recognize that. And now what is this part? Well, this is the translated function f. Right, notice how right next to t we have minus b. So that represents the translated function f. So this kind of translation, well, it's a horizontal shift. That means that we take this function and we shift it or move it b units to the right. And the fact that it's being multiplied by the unit step function at b, we already know that this indicates that it's being turned on at b. And as a result, this is how the graph is going to look like. So function f first got translated b units to the right, and then it got turned on at b. And that's why we can see there this entire curve. And from 0 to b, of course, it's just 0 because of this unit step function. And here is our last example. If we use everything that we've learned so far, we're going to be able to quickly understand what we're looking at here. So first of all, the function that's being multiplied by the unit step functions is function f of t minus a. So once again, this is translated function or shifted function. So function f of t, this one, was shifted a units to the right. So this curve will literally move. So it starts at a. And then what portion of the function is turned on in this case? Well, we already recognize the structure. We saw it in example 4. In this case, the portion between a and b is being turned on. So that's how the graph is going to look like. Function f was shifted to start at a. That's where we see the beginning of the curve. So this portion, but it's shifted, so we can see beginning of that curve. And it's turned on between a and b. So that's why we only see that piece. Before that and after that, the overall value of this function is 0. Okay, so that's the idea of the unit step function or Heaviside step function. And that's how it can be used in combination with other functions.